chatting to Midge. Midge, hello.
Hi.
Double celebration because we've got 35 years since the album Vienna and 30 years since Live Aid.
Oh, wow. Yes, of course. Yes.
So the year before Live Aid was Band Aid.
Yep.
Do They Know It's Christmas, which you did you write and produce it?
Yep.
Yes. And you herded a gaggle of pop stars into a studio. And it was such a success that yourself and Sir Bob thought, let's go bigger with this and we'll do Live Aid.
Yeah.
It was a televisual feat never before achieved, wasn't it? It was live at Wembley, live in Philadelphia.
So and many satellite feeds coming in from all over the world as well.
It'd never been done before, had it, something so
not
big.
To that scale, not on that scale at all. It was quite a bizarre thing to undertake. But we were fortunate that we had on the board of the Band Aid Trustees, which is the body of people we put together to oversee the money, the spending of the money from the Band Aid record.
Yeah.
One of the trustees was Michael Grade, now Lord Michael Grade, who was the head of the BBC, so he was a handy man to have, really.
Helpful.
So, and he got us, you know, 5 hours of prime time television. Fantastic. Saturday afternoon.
How did you get roped into all this, you know, with writing and producing Band Aid? Did Bob, were you and Bob close mates?
Bob and I had known each other since I was in the Rich Kids, I suppose, and he was starting out the Boomtown Rats, and he used to come and see the Rich Kids when we were in Ireland and stuff. And we just known each other, and of course, Bob's girlfriend at the time, soon to become his wife, Paula, yeah. Paula Yates, was a journalist, so she knew everybody. She was the connector, you know. So I'd known Bob and Paula, and we used to hang out together and things. But and it was because I was talking to Paula, who was hugely pregnant, on a TV show, The Tube, and Bob was at home kind of twiddling his thumbs because the Boomtown Rats had been and gone.
Yeah.
And Bob called Paula, and Paula said, Midge is here, and he said, let me speak to him, and then told me that he'd just seen the first footage that Michael Burke at the BBC had shown on the news. And he said, I'm disgusted and I want to do something. Can we talk? Can we get together? And we got together a couple of days later and came to the very obvious conclusion that we're not skilled at anything whatsoever, except, you know, maybe writing a song. And we thought if we could have a number one record, we could maybe, with the help of all our friends, raise £100,000.
How much did it raise in the end?
I think it's still going because obviously every time that record gets played, it generates income.
Yeah.
So I think around the time it was £6 or £7 million.
Wow. And why did people say yeah to appearing on the record and then later on Live Aid? I mean, what is it? Has Bob got, you and Bob got secrets on everybody?
You know, Bob's just Bob's a rock bailer. You know, nobody says no to him because, you know, he's incredibly intelligent and hugely passionate about this stuff. And you just do not say no. He's just got a way of convincing you that you are totally in the wrong and he is absolutely right. And it wasn't a difficult thing, I don't suppose, when we were doing the Band Aid record. I think in hindsight, you've got to look back and realise that by the time Bob and I had spoken about what we would do, we had to write a Christmas song.
Yeah.
We couldn't just cover someone else's because 50% of the money generated would go to the writers.
Of course,
so we had to write something and then donate the money. So we decided a Christmas song because the charts freeze over the Christmas New Year period, therefore you can sell twice as many as you normally would any other time of the year. And by the time I had gotten home to my little house in Chiswick in London and Bob had gotten home to his place in King's Road, he had bumped into Gary Kemp from Spandau Ballet and Simon Le Bon from Duran, two of the biggest bands of the day, who both agreed to do whatever this was before even writing the song.
He did it at B&Q. Who was he? Just bumped into these people. When you look back to Live Aid now, what sort of emotions do you feel? And I mean, can you remember like the night before? Did you get any sleep the night before at all? Were you in a...
I don't think anyone did. The week running up to the actual concert, I'd been in Los Angeles. I was about to supposedly release my first solo album. So I was over there having photographs done by this very famous Hollywood photographer from the 1940s. Beautiful photographs. And I flew back the day before the concert, so I was completely jet-lagged and turned up at the stadium to check the equipment, make sure it all worked. And then everything just kind of went in a flash. I don't remember the night before. I do remember the only way the artist could get into the stadium on the day was flying in by helicopter, which sounded very flash, but very scary, really.
Didn't they fly onto a cricket pitch?
We flew onto some kind of bit of grass next to it. And there's a great story, I think, about David Bowie. There was a wedding going on. Someone was getting married in this flat bit of ground, and a helicopter comes down and lands. And David Bowie pops out the plane and has his photograph taken with the young couple getting married. But it was that realization that after talking about this for weeks and weeks and weeks and organizing all of this stuff, the Band-Aid Trust, all kind of doing the teamwork thing, that when you flew over the stadium and you saw all these people outside the stadium waiting to get in, it all of a sudden became real.
And because the crowd itself wasn't like a rock crowd, or wasn't a normal gig-going crowd, it was just music lovers. It was just like the general population who had got caught up in this idea where they could just see all these amazing artists, like, you know, Queen, Elton John, Bowie, you know, all in the same place, Spandau, like you say. And it was just, they were all just there for this one big reason. So it must have been pretty emotional.
And I think it was, I think the audience realised that the ticket they had in their hand that let them into that was something really special. It was like Willy Wonka. You know, they had got the golden ticket and they were there. They were only, they were one of 80 or 90,000 people, whatever it was, in the stadium who were lucky enough to see it. So when, even today, people come up and say, I've still got my ticket, I was there. And I think, wow, I'm meeting people who were actually there because it's such a a unique, special thing. So yeah, it was a glorious thing.
Incredible. Now, when you look back, there's a lot of standout performances and lot, but for you on the day, you obviously had to perform as well with Ultravox. So were you happy with your performance? Because I've spoken to so many 80s stars on this show who were there. So was there no sound check?
No sound check.
People hated their outfit, they forgot their words because it was just so terrifying. How did you feel beforehand and looking back? I mean, I hope you like it because we are going to play Vienna. We're going to play your performance in just a second.
Well, yeah, I think the clothes side of things, you know, people are saying, why were you wearing a raincoat? And, which I was, you know, raincoat and dark glasses. And it's, the answer is because I could, you know, I could do what I liked. But everyone had, all the artists had the 18 minutes on stage, that's all. And when you walked on stage to go and do your performance, no sound check, and especially in Ultravox's case where you're using technology, synthesizers, anything could have gone wrong. And just as you're about to walk on stage, the stage manager says, there's a traffic light system either side of the stage. You walk on, it'll be green. At 16 minutes, it goes amber, and you won't see it turn red because the power goes off. You think, because it's the only way we could get to keep the whole thing on schedule.
I mean, were you literally like high-fiving the band who'd been on before you as they leave with their guitars and
kind of. There was a rotary stage, so you were kind of there. Your equipment would be set up while the other band was playing.
Wow.
And the stage would turn, and then you'd walk on and do your thing.
Another technical thing as well as all the satellites and all the timings to worry about this
things,
stage.
Of all the things that could have gone wrong, on the day, I think Paul McCartney's mic went towards the end. It was a logistical heaven because, I mean, it was a nightmare, but it turned to heaven simply because it all worked. You know, only a couple of minor things happened.
Well, during Vienna, you look like you're having a ball. You look like you're really enjoying it. And we're going to relive the magic now as we see Ultravox performing at Live Aid with Vienna.
Freezing breath on the window pane, lying waiting.
So that was Vienna, performed of course by Ultravox at Live Aid in 1985. You look happy there, Midge.
Yeah, I think relief and sheer ecstatic. Yeah. I mean, it was great. It was such a, you could have cut the atmosphere and taken it home. You know, it was just wonderful.
Must have been just such a buzz on that. Such an amazing crowd.
Well, the audience was singing along, and they were doing that fabulous, you know, Radio Gaga hand clap, pointing in the air thing to the Vienna drum beat. It was just electric. It was fabulous.
And backstage, what was it like? Was it just a plethora of pops? I mean, were there any room for egos that day? Because I guess people were pretty much shoved on and off stage, weren't they?
They were. Everyone knew why they were there. You know, there was no doubt. There was no grey area. You know, you're there for a reason. You're there for the cause, and that's it. But there was a great moment just prior to the concert kicking off. They put all the artists in this massive big green room, a big holding area full of, you know, rock stars and pop stars and stuff. And without a word to each other, the different genres of music all collected together. So you'd get all the kind of electronic guys all gathering in one corner.
And the new romantics
in one corner, all kind of checking out each other's outfits. And then you get the kind of rockers over in the other corner. Cool. And it was great because the whole day opened up with Status Quo being rocking all over the world.
Who were a little bit controversial in some aspect because they weren't seen as cutting edge and they'd been around for a bit, but they really handled themselves out there, didn't they?
You couldn't find a better song to kick off rocking all over the world.
Yeah,
a global concert. It was just amazing. So they had to be there for that. But backstage, everyone's milling about and hanging around and whatever, and then you hear Status Quo fire up, rocking all over the world, and you look round the room and everyone's heads and feet were going, everyone's going, wow, what's happening? Amazing. This is great. And the buzz started at that moment.
And Lady Di was there, wasn't she? Lady Diana was there. Oh, she Princess Diana by then, I think. Mm. Yes, and with Prince Charles. And she was a huge sort of pop music fan.
Yeah.
So was that kind of an extra buzz? Were you in the lineup along with Elton and everyone to meet the royals?
Not that day, I wasn't, no. It was just,
how
dare she? I was snubbed. I think the great thing about that was the royals were only allowed to be there for an hour, security. Right. And by all accounts, Princess Diana went home and watched the rest of it on television in her bedroom. And she was very miffed that she wasn't allowed to stay the whole day.
Yeah.
Because it was her thing, you know.
Yeah, it was totally
the Prince's Trust and all of that. It was all her, you know, her thing.
Yeah, she loved music, didn't she? And the lasting legacy of Live Aid. And you visited Ethiopia. How many times have you been there? When was your most recent trip?
A few times. I think the last time I went was probably 3-4 years ago.
Yeah. And can you see where the money's gone? And can you see the difference that it's made and the legacy that's left behind?
I went with the initial aid that the Band Aid record purchased. Either Bob or I had to go, or the cameras wouldn't go. So I went there and I came back after only being in Ethiopia for 12, 14 hours, whatever. I came back vowing I'd never go again.
Yeah.
because it was harrowing. You know, it was, you know, I'm a musician. I'm not cut out for that stuff.
Yeah.
And I went back 20 years later as an ambassador for Save the Children. And they said, you've got to go back and see the difference and see the difference that it's made. Because it's been a big question for 30 years, did it make a difference? Mm. I went back and I met the difference. I spoke to people who were in aid camps, who were kids who had lost their families, lost everyone, everything. And they survived. Because people put their hand in a pocket and donated to that concert or bought that record or whatever.
Yeah.
So part of the ongoing legacy, yes, it's great. You know, look at Africa now, it's a very different country now, a very different series of countries.
Yeah.
And it's made a massive difference. And of course, even here, part of the legacy is that every time that record is played, it still generates income.
Yeah. You know, and as a person, you must have you've got to have some pride there that you were part of something so massive. I mean, obviously people bought the record and people pledged their money, but for you personally, you know, when you're sitting there in the retirement home for old pop stars, when you're sitting in Dunrocking with your tartan blanket over your lap, you've got to be proud of the hard work that went in there.
I'm proud of the industry. The music industry was is notoriously shark infested, selfish industry, and the industry itself gave up the profits. They made Band Aid happen.
Yeah.
They made that thing that we thought would generate £100,000. They turned it into the £7 million because they didn't take the profits. The retailers didn't take the profits. All of that stuff. So the industry, for the first time ever, had done something great for the world, and it was great. So in retrospect, yes, you can look at it and think, you know, rather than pride, I think I was glad to be part of it. I was glad to be there.
It's like an honour to be part
of
it. We're going to finish with a standout moment now from Queen. Can you remember when Queen took to the stage and Freddie just owned it?
They were magnificent. I mean, many artists did their 18 minutes different ways.
Mm.
Queen had worked out exactly 18 minutes of the greatest hits.
Okay.
And they went on there, and Freddie was in his element. You know, he commanded the audience. They had them in the palm of his hand. You know, he'd do his singing thing, and then they all sing back to him, and wonderful stuff. But they did this 18 minutes of non-stop wham, bam, 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 hit after hit after hit, and reminded the world of the brilliant band that they were.
Well, let's watch it now then. We Will Rock You, We Are the Champions, from Queen, playing at Live Aid.